Hello, welcome everyone to this event, Destination 2030, Making 1.5 a Reality. This event is convened by the UN Climate Champions in partnership with the COP26 Presidency. I'm delighted to now welcome to the stage Vice President Al Gore.
Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and I have the job of opening this session, but you're going to hear from the climate champions and the UK presidency, and they will fill in any gaps that I leave in my remarks. But what I would like to cover, first of all, I would like to say thanks to all of you for being a part of this historic event. I would like to encourage you to do even more, because here we are nearing the halfway point of this historic conference, and much remains to be done. But I would also like to note that much has been achieved already. Some of it is in the form of pledges that must be kept, and part of our task, all of us, is to ensure that these pledges are, in fact, kept. I was heartened at the very opening of COP26 when Secretary General Guterres announced, among other things, that he is forming a new group within the United Nations to monitor and assess and regularly report on all of the net zero pledges made by non-state actors. Those who have made pledges should understand very clearly that their actions will matter a great deal, and that any mismatch between their pledges and their subsequent actions will be noted very carefully. And civil society throughout the world is prepared to hold all of us accountable for matching deeds to words. We will see a continued surge in momentum to solve the climate crisis. Part of that momentum will come from Mother Nature, because we are seeing, rather obviously, an increase in the frequency, intensity, and destructiveness of the climate-related extreme events. It reminds me of a famous quotation from a previous British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, who had been attempting to warn the world about the rise of fascism in the 1930s. And he made a speech in which he said, "The era of procrastination, of half measures, of soothing and baffling expedients, of delays, is coming to its close. In its place, we are entering a period of consequences." We are now experiencing the consequences of the climate crisis in every part of our world. The scientists warned us that these consequences were coming. Too many did not pay careful enough attention to those warnings. But because their warnings were proven to be spot on and exactly correct, if actually a bit conservative, we must pay even more careful attention to the warnings that they are giving us now. The latest sixth assessment of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which was released in August, contains the most dire warnings that the scientific body of experts has ever given us. What we have experienced so far is nothing compared to what would take place if we do not meet the pledges that have already been made here in Glasgow. The science is unequivocal, to quote the IPCC, and people are now experiencing it for themselves. But there is optimism as well as danger, because within the IPCC assessment is some rather hopeful news alongside their warnings. If we actually do reach net zero, when we do, Earth's temperatures will stop going up with a lag time of as little as 3 to 5 years. It is as if we can throw a switch and save the future of our civilization. And when we reach net zero, half of all the human-caused CO2 in the troposphere will fall back out of the sky and be absorbed by the upper levels of the ocean and the trees and vegetation in as little as 25 to 30 years. And a long healing process can then begin. Most significantly, perhaps, we will then be able to say to the young people who are out in the streets of Glasgow and have been out in the streets of cities all over the world every Friday and other days besides, demanding that we legitimize their expectations for a future that is worthy of them. We can do so, but we must put the period of delay and distraction and expedience in the past, recognize that we have entered a period of consequences, and make it a period of solutions. Some of the pledges that we have heard here this week will take a tremendous amount of work and creativity in order to redeem them. But we must hold them to account. And I would also point out that we are entering an era of radical transparency. We are now seeing more and more satellites and ground, sea, and air-based sensors, internet data streams, crowdsourced information gathering, and Climate Trace, an organization that I have helped co-found, is now using artificial intelligence to fuse together all of these data streams to develop extremely accurate and precise algorithms that can affix responsibility for every significant greenhouse gas source of emissions on our planet. We have already published the first independent, comprehensive, and timely inventory, nation by nation, industry by industry, sector by sector. Partway through next year, we will upgrade that inventory as the machine learning algorithms continue to improve, and we will report regularly, not only on a monthly basis as now, but weekly and in many cases on a daily basis. We have access to a complete picture of the entire Earth's surface every day, and soon we will have a complete picture of every square centimeter of the Earth's surface every 6 hours. And we are imaging in the visible range of light, also in infrared, and in multiple other wavelength spectrums. We're supplementing that with all of the other sources of data, and we are compiling a comprehensive list of those who are responsible for each of the entities that are emitting greenhouse gases, not to be the climate police, but to be the neighborhood watch, except the neighborhood is the globe, and we are all in this together. And when we have actionable information, I promise you, the demand for change will grow and grow and grow. We must keep at the center of our concerns the poor, the low-income communities, the communities of color and marginalized communities that have suffered the most from the climate crisis already. We should understand the connectedness of our entire world, not as a figure of speech, not as a metaphor, but as a reality. The pandemic has raised many of the same exact questions that have been raised by the climate crisis. Number one, should we listen to the dire warnings from the leading scientific experts, whether about an oncoming pandemic or a worsening climate crisis? Check. We should listen to them. Number two, can our interconnected global civilization suddenly be turned upside down in short order? Check. We've seen it with the pandemic, and the scientists are telling us it will be far worse unless we take control of the causes of this worsening climate crisis. The Lancet Commission has now told us that we could, if we do not act, expect to see 1 billion climate refugees migrating across borders. My faith tradition teaches me to welcome the refugee, to welcome the stranger. But my previous lifetime as a recovering politician in the world of government and politics has taught me that a large surge of immigration or migration in a short period of time can, because of the darker recesses of human nature, trigger xenophobia and anger and even violence and exclusion and soft violence and slow violence. We cannot allow this wave of authoritarian populism to spread around our world. But we must also take account of the hyper inequality in our world, and we should seize the effort, ongoing effort to solve the climate crisis as an opportunity to redress this inequality. I had a good friend who was president of Bolivia decades ago, a very brilliant and good man. And he said, Al, inequality is a bit like inflation. You will always have at least a little, and at least a little is not a bad thing. And in the markets, we know that some inequality is always present. But he said, like inflation, you must at all costs avoid the hyper variety, because hyper inequality of the kind we now have in our world is a threat to both democracy and to market economics. Capitalism has tremendous strengths, allocating resources, balancing supply and demand, often unlocking a higher fraction of the human potential. And the alternatives to capitalism we experienced in the 20th century were catastrophic, most of all for the environments in which these alternatives were tried. But the current version of capitalism we have is in dire need of reform, because we are overly focused on one narrow slice of the value spectrum, the interests of short-term incentives in the hands of shareholders. What about the air? What about the value of the mountains and the ocean and the web of living species that we are now putting at risk? What about the plight of the poor? We have an opportunity as a global community to take advantage of a new era in human history. We are in the early stages of a sustainability revolution that is driven in part by machine learning and artificial intelligence and the Internet of Things and stunning advances in biotechnology, which are giving executive teams the ability to deal with atoms and molecules and proteins with the same proficiency that the IT companies have demonstrated in dealing with bits of information. This sustainability revolution has the magnitude of the Industrial Revolution and the speed of the digital revolution. For example, many are not aware that last year, in calendar year 2020, if you look at all of the new electricity generation installed worldwide in every country, 90% of it is renewable energy, most all of that solar and wind. Why? Because we have seen such stunning advances. 1 year before the Paris Agreement in 2015, electricity from renewable sources was cheaper than electricity from new fossil sources in only 1% of the world. 5 years later, it was cheaper in two-thirds of the world. And 3 years from now, it will be cheaper in 100% of the world. Now we see every auto and truck manufacturer switching to electric vehicles. And soon, within 2 to 3 years, two for most model categories, 3 to 4 years for all model categories,
Electric vehicles will be cheaper than their internal combustion engine counterparts. That's why every significant automobile and truck manufacturer in the world is rapidly shifting to emissions-free electric vehicles. We are seeing the emergence of green hydrogen. Why? Because in the past, it was prohibitively expensive to buy all of the energy necessary to separate hydrogen from oxygen. And so it was made from fossil fuels, also at great expense. But now, with the surplus of renewable electricity, we can make it from water pollution-free and use it for the high-temperature use cases like metallurgy. We have the tools that we need to solve this crisis. We have heard pledges that will move us in a long direction toward these solutions. We must ensure that these pledges are kept. We must not declare victory here. We know that we have made progress, but we are far from the goals that we need to reach. The missing requisite is sufficient political will. But part of our job here is to tell one another the truth about how far we've come and about how far we have to go, and recognize that political will is itself a renewable resource. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice President Gore. It is now my honor to welcome to the stage Wanjira Maathai.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President, always inspiring. We have the tools. I like that. When I was young, I thought that failure was impossible. All wrongs would be righted in my time. Now I'm old, I see that failure is impossible. So I pass the torch to you. Will you hold it high? For we are sowing winter wheat that other hands will harvest, that they might have enough to eat after we are gone. We'll plant shade trees that we will not sit under. We'll struggle for justice, though we'll never see it flower. We'll light candles so others might see their way. Our children's children will live in peace one day. When I was young, I thought there were no human enemies. All people must be taught to hate and fear. Now I'm old, I know there are no human enemies, just souls in pain, and we must reach them if we dare. So we are sowing winter wheat that other hands will harvest, that they might have enough to eat after we are gone. We'll plant shade trees that we will not sit under. Each generation passes like the leaves of an old oak tree whose roots are strong. Each new generation bursts out like the spring, and they will be the ones to carry on. When I was young, I dreamed the earth was healed and whole again. Creatures, trees, and rivers, free and wild. Now I'm old, I dream the planet healed and whole again. That dream reborn forever in the heart of every child. Ladies and gentlemen, these words are an invitation to all of us to do our part in making Destination 2030 a reality. Because here's the thing, the climate crisis is embedded within the global context of historic, systemic, and growing inequality. And this continues to perpetuate deep poverty, resource exploitation, unemployment, and the unjust distribution of the burden of pollution and emissions. Destination 2030 will only be within reach if we put rural, urban, and energy transitions at the center and acknowledge and address all of these pain points. It has to be just, inclusive, and equitable. If the transition away from fossil fuels, for example, is not just, it simply will not be sustainable. On energy, it's great. It's great to see countries taking action to shift the world away from fossil fuels towards a clean energy future. After all, the IPCC is crystal clear on this, that to avert a climate disaster, our addiction to fossil fuels must end, and phasing out financing is a crucial step forward. But as the clean energy transition accelerates, it is imperative that we also simultaneously, ladies and gentlemen, simultaneously accelerate the universal access to energy in developing countries and ensure the just transition that lifts everyone and leaves no one behind. Because while transition is inevitable, justice simply isn't. So in the same vein, it must be noted that some countries are signing on to the pledge to end fossil fuel finance overseas, but continue to subsidize fossil fuel industries at home. To be credible, accountable, and transparent climate leaders, these nations must also stop the subsidizing of fossil fuels domestically and shift towards cleaner sources of energy at home. This climate moment represents a unique opportunity and an opportunity for countries to provide locally led, people-centered, sustainable economies for all. So as we move forward into this week, let's take three words with us: accountability, credibility, and transparency, because transition is inevitable, but justice is not. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to welcome to the stage the UN High-Level Climate Champion for COP26, Nigel Topping, and Lord Adair Turner, the Chair of the Energy Transitions Commission. Welcome, dear. Welcome, gentlemen. Lord Adair Turner, as the Chair of the Energy Transitions Commission, you recently released a report, Keeping 1.5, and you have it right there, alive, articulating some of the feasible technological actions that could close this gap. So COP26 has already revealed a range of announcements. You've been hearing them all week. What has happened in the last 4 days that is going to keep 1.5 within reach?
Well, I've got to present some maths, so I'm going to go up to the lectern to do it. Thank you, Wanjira. After Wanjira's poetry, my job is the prose, or indeed the mathematics. Though I have to tell you that Nigel is a mathematician by training, and when I said I was going to say that, he said, but mathematics is beautiful, it's a poetry in itself. Now, the Paris Climate Accord committed the world to limit global warming to well below 2 degrees centigrade, and ideally to 1.5 degrees centigrade. And to keep that possibility of 1.5 degrees alive, and indeed to make staying below 2 degrees not just possible, but close to certain, we must not only build a net zero global economy by mid-century, but make big emissions reductions in the 2020s. So ahead of the COP, as Wanjira said, we at the Energy Transition Commission set out in this report six actions which could build on the NDCs to achieve the reductions required. And the question after 1 week of COP and many new commitments is, how close are we to closing the gap? And I hope at this stage a slide is going to turn up. There it is. One vital priority is cutting methane emissions. They are 380 million tons in 2018, coming from fossil fuel production, waste management, and food production, primarily meat. And methane, as I'm sure all of you know, is a hugely powerful greenhouse gas, and cutting methane emissions is the fastest acting tool we have to limit global temperature rise. And the good news is that there are many ways to reduce methane emissions at low or negative costs. And we believe that potentially we could cut emissions 40% from 380 million tons to 230 by 2030, and very little of that potential is already reflected in NDCs. Sometimes it seems that methane is the sort of orphan gas of the climate change process. We just ignore it a bit and don't talk about it enough. So it is great to have seen this week and in the run-up to COP the potential reflected in the Global Methane Pledge, with countries accounting for 45% of global methane emissions committing to achieve a 30% cut. Provided those commitments are met, that could cut methane emissions 50 million tons by 2030. Not the full 130 million tons we could and should achieve, but a good start for further progress. As for CO2, the challenge is to cut emissions from the 43 gigatons which they could reach on a business as usual path to something like 21 gigatons by 2030, a reduction of about 22 gigatons. About 3 gigatons of that needed reduction is implied by the new NDC commitments. But our analysis identified 5 other actions that could close the gap. Actions as you go down that cascade of the waterfall, from nature-based solutions, actions in the power sector, transport, industry, and energy efficiency. So how do we now stand? Well, the good news, potentially, is a big step forward in relation to nature, with a commitment to end deforestation, which if, and I do emphasize this if supported by adequate climate finance and clearly implemented and enforced, would itself result in 3.5 gigatons of emissions reductions. That commitment is a huge step forward. Delivering it is a crucial priority. As for the power sector, if we could agree to no new coal plants anywhere in the world from now on, and to begin the phase out of older existing coal plants during the 2020s, that could save us as much as 3.5 gigatons by 2030. And the global coal to clean power transition statement is a step forward towards that objective, with coal-dependent countries from across the world, from Poland and Ukraine to Vietnam and Indonesia, making important new commitments. But with India and China not among the signatories, and with phase-out commitments focused on the 2030s and 40s, this in itself will only deliver 0.2 gigatons of the 3.5 gigatons potential by 2030. In addition, however, the country, company, and financial sector commitments of the Powering Past Coal Alliance and the innovative South Africa finance deal, plus commitments to accelerate renewables investments, which will inevitably displace coal because it's uneconomic, could give us another 1 gigaton. Valuable, vital, but still much more to do. In industry and transport, many of the commitments will come next week, not this. But on road transport, country and auto manufacturer plans and commitments already made within the Race to Zero framework or outside make us pretty confident that road transport electrification is going to go much faster than most NDCs assume, likely delivering at least an additional 1.5 gigatons reductions. Let's add it all up. The NDCs and the sectoral commitments, add them together, and we look like we're on a path to about 9 gigatons out of the 22 gigaton reduction needed, with a potential for further important commitments next week. That's progress. But even with more progress next week on steel, aviation, and shipping, we won't achieve here in Glasgow the full 22 gigatons we need. We won't be able to leave Glasgow saying, job done, mission accomplished. But we have new commitments made which can make a real difference and which must be delivered. And we have a springboard for the further progress needed over the next several years, sector by sector and country by country, reflected in improved NDCs. We must maintain the momentum of the first week. We must maximize progress over the next week, and we must leave Glasgow determined to do still more in the coming months and years. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Turner. Thank you, Lord Turner, for those wonderful pieces of data. Absolutely, we must keep 1.5 alive. Nigel, you are responsible. You have a mandate as a champion for the role of non-state actors across the world, businesses, hospitals, universities, cities, all of them. Looking ahead next week, what are you thinking about the critical role of non-state actors in the road ahead? What do you think the real economy has to add?
Well, I mean, the first thing I would say is it feels like this is very much an implementation COP, a real economy COP. I think that having a theme every day has been very helpful for non-state actors to organize their presence and their commitments. I think we're also seeing evidence of what Gonzalo Munoz, my fellow high-level champion, and I always talk about the ambition loop, this feedback between parties and non-parties. We've seen quite a lot this week of party commitments and non-party commitments. And we know that they embolden each other, so that process happening. I think that shows evidence of the wisdom of the parties in embracing the role of non-state actors and the creation of the role that Gonzalo and I are honored to hold, that it's working. I think, as Adair said, an awful lot, a long way to go. I think also we're seeing evidence of the way that systems change actually happens with all different actors starting to converge on the same. I'm also sensing that we are moving away from concentrating on the cost of action versus the cost of inaction to the huge developmental opportunity. Moody's just published a report today showing that the world's economy will be 25% bigger if we stay on a 1.5 degree track than if we stay on the track we're on at the moment. And of course, most of that economic growth will be in emerging and developing countries. So as Nick Stern says, it's the economic growth story. We've heard a lot about the evidence of transformation. We always talk about the way that industrial transformation happens exponentially. I hope that we're seeing the beginning signs of that. I think it's too early to declare victory, of course, in many sectors. And I hope that all the businesses watching are starting to wish that they'd started a bit earlier, because a lot of people are going very, very fast. But just to come back to this idea of systems change, we simplify it by saying public policy and private sector. But of course, what we're seeing now is a real convergence on common goals, collectively, roughly halving by the end of the decade, getting to net zero by 2050, but also sector by sector. And that convergence is now from, yes, governments, but also private sector on the supply side and the demand side, the finance community, city leaders, and civil society. And involving young people, smallholder farmers, trades unions, all driving towards the same goals. And when every actor in a system drives towards the same goal, I think that's where we have the conditions for that exponential growth. So I'm cautiously optimistic that we're starting to see the conditions for really rapid transformation be put in place.
Great, Nigel. Thank you for that. And the interesting thing you said about the cost of inaction, I think that is waking people up, looking at the cost of inaction. And I wonder, when you look into your crystal ball about week two, Lord Turner, I'll start with you. What is your hope for next week?
Well, Nigel's much more of an expert on the details of the choreography of this, but I think there are some sectors where we haven't yet focused in the first week, and they're very important sectors. Steel. We at the ETC, in the combination with a thing called the Mission Possible Partnership, put out 2 weeks ago the Net Zero Steel Initiative report. And it said something which would really have surprised me 3 years ago. It was not only that steel could get to net zero by 2050, but that actually with enough regulatory support, carbon pricing support, it could reduce emissions 35% by 2030. And that's worth another gigaton. That's a chunky one. And what has happened in that sector is that technologies which we used to think would develop in the 2030s are suddenly developing today. Hydrogen. It's unfortunate I left my bag back there, because if I hadn't left it there, I could now bring out for you an ingot of net zero emission steel made in the SSAB plant in northern Sweden out of hydrogen direct reduction. People used to think that was a technology which we had another 10 or 15 years to develop, but it's there now already. So we are seeing in many sectors of the economy, and we're also seeing it in aviation and shipping, people bringing forward the dates at which we think we can get serious emission reductions and serious progress. And so I hope that those, as well as more on road transport electrification, where, look, the aim should be that we call a halt to the passenger internal combustion engine by 2035 at the latest. I sometimes say, I'm probably about to upset somebody now, the internal combustion engine is dead, we just haven't buried it. This is an old technology and we're going to move beyond it, and the faster we get absolute clarity of the dates beyond which we're not going to sell new internal combustion engine passenger cars, the better.
That's absolutely fantastic. And I think that's true, but I want to come back to you, Lord Turner, about why that message doesn't seem to be landing. Because it is true, the combustion ICE is dead, but we still seem to have a much slower transition. It would be great to hear. But I want to turn to you, Nigel. What do you hope for? You talked about the all of society engaged. What do you hope for week two?
Well, I mean, one thing I hope is that we all start to embrace this idea of an ambition loop, like the feedback between public and private. Sometimes governments can go faster, sometimes private sector can go faster, sometimes finance can go faster, sometimes cities can go faster. It's not a competition for who's always in the lead, but when somebody else goes a bit further, that enables everyone else. Particularly, I think we're entering a very dynamic phase in this transition where I don't think there's any business that is only updating their plans every 5 years, or think anything to sort of embrace that dynamism and say, look, we really need to update our plans every year or every 2 years, because what we thought was impossible 2 years ago is happening now. So if we wait, you know, so we can't wait. So I hope that infects the mood. I hope that we really stick to pragmatism, don't get carried away with 2050 promises, but really focus on what are people actually going to do in the next 5 years. What are they already doing now? What are they committing money to in terms of capacity for green hydrogen or green steel? So it's not a promise, but an actual commitment. I hope that we continue to be honest about the challenges, because it's far from in the bag, and that we keep solidarity in mind, that there are different pathways needed, responding to different local conditions in different parts of the world. Just a reflection on this issue of credibility. You know, I started my work in this space in 2007 with the Carbon Disclosure Project, which was formed in 2001. And now, finally, 20 years later in 2021, we're starting to see regulated carbon disclosure. We can't afford 20 more years to regulate net zero plans and disclosure. So I really applaud the announcement from Rishi Sunak of mandatory disclosure of net zero transition plans from listed companies. You know, in the race to zero, we're very clear about the rigorous requirements of short-term plans, in a mitigation hierarchy which doesn't allow offsets to displace real reductions, the need for transparency. Really looking forward to working with the Secretary General on how we work to make sure that all gets regulated within 5 years and we don't leave it up to NGOs to police that for 20 years. We haven't got the time.
Yeah. We absolutely don't have the time. We have a few more minutes to just, I would love to hear your thoughts, both of you, on what it will take for us to hasten. What do you say to those who feel like there are some delay tactics? The evidence is there, the data is clear. We still are not moving fast enough. What do we need to do different? Lord Adair.
When I look back at the last 10 years, I think we lost a lot of the first five. I don't think we were making nearly enough progress technologically. You still had developed countries back in 2013 or 14, the Netherlands, intending to build new coal-fired power stations. And it shouldn't have happened. I mean, we ought to have grabbed this thing earlier. I've got much more optimistic over the last 5 years because the technologies are roaring on. After Paris, this sort of Paris effect of a self-reinforcing loop between what companies have, what countries are committed to. I mean, I was the first chair of the UK Climate Change Committee in 2008, We were given an Act of Parliament in 2006, which was seen as ahead of the game then, which committed us to a 60% reduction by 2050. Our very first recommendation in 2008 was to increase that commitment to 80%, right. And we thought we were being bold. And it was only in 2019 that the UK legally said zero. So let's be aware, in terms of targets, we've come a long way. In terms of corporate targets, we've come a long way. In terms of the technologies which make those targets credible, we've come a long way. And we now just have to hit the accelerator as fast as possible during the 2020s. But it is doable.
That seemed wonderful. We lost the first five. That's crucial. Nigel, what do you think?
The first thing I'd say is, everybody, brush up on your exponential maths. None of this stuff happens linearly. So, and don't accept anyone saying, oh, electric vehicles are only at 5%. The question is, if they were at 2% a year ago, then they more than doubled. And if they do that again, they'll go 10, 20, 40, 80, boom, it's all over. And that's the way always technology-driven industrial transformation has happened. So brush up on your exponential maths, call people out who've forgotten that and are still using silly linear extrapolations. Let's not use any scenarios which don't get us to the future we want as normative. So for example, a scenario which says, if we stick to all the policies we've got now, we fail. I mean, that's not really a scenario because no one's gonna stop policy making, right? What that's not feasible. So let's only use scenarios that actually get there. We've tried to work with the high-level champions team in the Marrakesh partnership to set these exponential goals for 2030, calling the race to zero 2030 breakthrough goals, that based on that idea of exponential. And we see more and more momentum in that direction. The report from Systemic that just came out says that sectors representing 90% of emissions could reach those tipping points by 2030. And so the final thing I say is, let's set those really ambitious targets and back our engineers and our ingenuity to solve them. You know, it's the old idea of the moonshot. If you set a target which is more than anyone knows how to do today, it unlocks the creative and innovative juices. And we need to set those challenging targets because we need to get there faster.
We do need to get there faster. It's about all the time we have, but hit the accelerator. I take that with me, and we need those ambitious targets, but we need credible trajectories and pathways there. Thank you all very much. Thank you so much, Lord Adair. Thank you, Nigel. This concludes our panel, and I would like to welcome to the stage Gonzalo Munoz. He's the UN High Level Champion on COP26. Carlos.
So thanks so much. I think that was a brilliant intervention, and now that definitely allow us to start a new conversation. Our guests, welcome to what we feel is one of the most valuable and the most challenging conversations of this conference. A conversation based on trust, based on common goals, and based on shared challenges. What we've just heard from brilliant people, very talented and knowledgeable people, is not the full picture. The 1.5 degree is not just about emissions reductions, facts, and figures. It's a human history. It's about building solidarity with the most exposed to climate risk, building resilience with those who need it the most, and ensuring that we rebuild trust with governments and with corporate players that have made promises to deliver a better world. Our dear ambassador for Race to Zero and Race to Resilience, the wonderful Sheila Patel, said it so beautifully earlier this week when she said that it will be the poor woman of the world who will know if we succeed at COP26. We know that a lot of this will be met with cynism. And as Vice President Al Gore said in his opening remarks, it's really right for us to hold these actors accountable for the pledges that they have made here in Glasgow. It's not only natural, it's good, it's healthy for all of us to be held accountable. Equally, we need to hold on to our hope and our ambition. We need to trust that they will deliver on the promises and commitments. And we need to work together in pursuit of a healthier, safer, more resilient zero-carbon world. So with that, I would like to welcome to the stage a diverse range of voices to hold this challenging conversation here today. So I'm welcoming Tasnim Esop, a leading climate justice advocate and director of CAN International. Welcome, Tasnim. Magali, yeah, round of applause, thank you. Magali Anderson, working tireless to shift one of the hardest to evade sectors onto a 1.5 trajectory from Holcim. Also Clover Hogan, a young climate leader, recognizing that today is Youth Day and knowing that thousands of young people are currently taking the streets to hold us all account for the promises we have made, as indeed we should be. And thank you. And finally, Johan Rockström, systems scientist and champion of the exponential shift needed by 2030 to deliver the 1.5 degree. Great. Thanks so much for joining. It's brilliant. It's an honor to be with the four of you. And I would like to start with you, Magali. We know we need to have a really honest conversation, mostly when it comes to all business leaders around the world. And obviously, the company that you represent is leading the way. We know that you've been working with Science-Based Target Initiative to develop a roadmap to decarbonize the whole cement industry. And in the spirit of honesty, what do you think are the key challenges you've been facing in your efforts to achieve the net zero emissions?
Thank you, Gonzalo, and very happy to have a honest question that requires a honest answer here. But maybe let me give you a very small context. If you think about what's happening in the world today, is there is a urbanization trend, there is a requirement for the energy transitions, there's all these needs, which mean that in the next 30 years, we will have to build the equivalent of New York City every single month. And we also know that cement represents about 7% of the total CO2 emissions. So you could say that's a challenge, and I could honestly answer you yes, but I'd rather say this is just a fantastic and incredible opportunity to change the way we are doing things. And we can do it. We can do it by many ways. You mentioned the fact that we have SBTI, we have our roadmap to net zero, but we have to look at the full value chain. The full value chain starts from the supplier side. For example, to deliver our product, we drive 1.2 billion miles per year, or about 2 billion kilometers for non-British people. And this is, so the first mover coalition that we joined yesterday is an incredible opportunity to all work together on the transport side. But then the rest of the value chain, we are talking about how do we design building? How do we make them more modular? How do we make them more circular? So today, we know how to do that. We know how to lower it. We know how to use 3D printing to lower by 70% the CO2. So we have all of that. And then we have the product. And the product, we have a global brand of green concrete, which is minimum 30% lower, but all the way to 70%, and sometimes in certain cases even more, which we have deployed in 24 markets. And the market is there. You can see we managed to actually sell some, and not just in Western Europe. We have seen, since we launched it in India, it's now representing 6% of the sales just a few months later. So the market is there. So really the question is, so I have all these pieces, and it all works, and we're all ready. So why can't I assemble it and make a nice pitch out of it? And this is where you intervene here in COP. This is where we have, like I said, an incredible opportunity to make it happen. And what we need is to anchor all of this in real economy. We need to be incentivized so that when we sell low carbon product, we actually have a competitive edge on it, that we it's good for us, it's good for everybody. And this is where we start talking about carbon pricing. This is where we start talking about norms evolving as fast as innovation does. And frankly, if tomorrow morning I could deploy this product everywhere and only sell that, I could do it. I'm ready. I'm just waiting for the green light. Oh, well, not waiting. We're already starting. But a further push would help to accelerate.
Thanks so much, Magali. Let me pass now to you, Johan. As we heard from Adair and Nigel, they pointed out that we can help to close the ambition gap and keep 1.5 in reach. What are the key elements you think they need? They might have missed? And why are you confident that we can make the immediate changes necessary to secure the 2030 deadlines that we need?
Yeah, thanks. And to identify the gaps we have so far, I think we have to start by looking very carefully, just following on what Nigel pointed out, that we see a real shift here in Glasgow. We see a shift where we no longer debate and fight over the direction of travel, but we're seeing rather a debate and concerns over the speed towards the same goal, a net zero world economy in a fair and safe way. So we're all swimming along the same swimming lanes. It's just a question of speed. So then the question is there reason to celebrate already now at half point? Well, there isn't, because there is a deep concern. Because if we had reached this point one generation ago when we met in Kyoto, I think we would have had reason to celebrate, because science would have said, yes, we can have a soft landing. This gives us a lot of time to really work on the forest pledges, on the methane pledges, on the coal phase out, on the combustion engine phase out, on all the technology innovations, all the S curves, all the equity dimensions. But now we are in an emergency point. We've reached the final decisive decade of our opportunity to land safely at 1.5, and 1.5 is a real planetary boundary. So there's no time to celebrate yet. We just have to keep up the efforts so that we can get more pledges and more efforts and more money on the table. So that is really critical. Science is guiding this. I think we've never seen such engagement from science in supporting this transition. But you know, the zero pledges do not yet add up. It is phenomenal that with India now on board on a zero target for 2070, too late for science, but still, it gives us a chance of moving just for the first time, just below 2 degrees. That is super important. It requires from us now to continue that pace. But I would say that the real gap here is that we are not yet recognized, and things have to now add up at the global level and at pace for this decade to cut emissions by half. Then my final concern at this point is that we are relying too much on nature being an easy fix, as if we don't have to put the trillions behind stewardship of nature climate solutions. It is very risky to say that cutting emissions by half by 2030 can now to 6 gigatons of the 20 gigatons that we need be provided by the forest pledge 2 days ago. It cannot. All the climate models that gives us a carbon budget of 400 gigatons for a soft landing of fossil fuel phase out rely on, and I've counted in, on nature climate sinks and forests being inside the models already. So the only reason why we have a climate carbon budget remaining is that we assume that nature will continue to provide a carbon sink. So we need full blast on nature investments, as we need full blast on decarbonizing the energy system. We cannot offset them against each other. The time for that is past. So now we really need to get that systems transition point, and I think that's a challenge for the next coming week.
Thanks so much, Johan. I would like to pass now to Clover. Clover, you've taught us a lot about eco-anxiety. I'm speaking now as a father of 3 girls that are kind of suffering the eco-anxiety. And I would like to listen if you can reflect on listening to everything that has just came before, right? The optimism and the challenges. How does this make you feel as a young person in the climate movement?
Thank you for asking me that question. I wish we started every conversation with asking one another how we feel. I frankly feel exhausted, frustrated, despairing at times, and motivated by the people who often aren't in these rooms, in fact, the people who have been historically excluded from these spaces. I invite you to look around now and ask, where are the young people? We are out in the streets protesting. We are protesting because we are angry, because we feel disillusioned, because we feel frustrated, and we are right to, because we have been raised to place our faith in institutions, in governments, in leaders who have been elected to safeguard our future, to safeguard all of life on this planet. And yet we have seen a failure of leadership. We have seen tokenism. We have seen an incremental approach. We've seen sustainability treated as a tick-boxing activity. And when we express our anxiety, when we express the feelings that keep us up at night, we are left out of the room. We're not being invited into these spaces. And so I think a lot of young people feel despair. In fact, in my organization, Force of Nature, we recently contributed to research that surveyed over 10,000 young people across 10 countries around the world. 56% of those young people agreed that they felt the future was doomed. And disproportionately, the young people who felt hopeless about the future are the young people who are experiencing the climate crisis today, not as a future threat, but who are losing their homes to wildfires, to flooding, to hurricanes. And so there is despair, an enormous amount of it. And the rise of eco-anxiety does not stem exclusively from the enormity and complexity of these crises, but from perceived inaction in the face of them. And yet I find courage and hope in the young people who, in spite of being excluded from historic corridors of power, have chosen to take agency and power back upon ourselves. Because I don't find hope in traditional spaces. There's a reason this is COP26 and we're still having these conversations. I find hope in Indigenous leaders who have been fighting this struggle for many more decades than I've been alive. I find hope in young voices. I find hope in the allies who have committed their entire lives to this fight. I do not find hope in corporate greenwash. I do not find hope in empty promises made far enough into the future that they require no immediate action. On my way up to Glasgow, I read that based on current commitments made by over 100 countries, including the UK, the US, and my home country of Australia, we are on track for a 16% increase in global greenhouse gas emissions over the next 10 years. This is when the climate science tells us we need to reduce emissions by 45%. So nothing that is not transformation is tokenism, and there is no hope in another 10 years of tokenism.
Thank you, Chloe. Well, I can imagine that that is a perfect segue to Tasnim. We've talked about the real economy. We've talked about the gap in the science. But Tasnim, can you please speak about the realities of what is happening on the front line and the lived experience of those that are mostly affected?
Thanks, Gonzalo, and thank you, Clover. I think it's you know, not something that many sitting in this room will be unfamiliar with, what's going on out there in the front lines. We've just come through nearly 2 years of having those front lines in our living rooms. The pandemic and the devastation caused by the pandemic, and the fact that that devastation was experienced differently by different sections of our societies, those who were suffering inequality, those who are living in poverty, those who are black, people of color, women, people with disabilities, indigenous communities, they suffered the most during a pandemic. These are the same communities across the world, whether global north or south, that also suffer the impact of climate change. Not in 2050, but now. And so you have the horrors of a pandemic and the devastation that caused in many of these communities and in especially the global south, compounded by the climate impacts that we witnessed last year, this year more frequently, with its flooding in Uganda, with its hurricanes, the Philippines taking a number of hits back to back. You're not recovering from a pandemic, you're being hit by a typhoon, and it's the poor and those suffering inequality that suffer the most. And during this period, we've seen, and I'm really pleased to hear Al Gore speak about hyper inequality. So any conversation that we have about the destination of 2030 cannot ignore the context in which we're having these discussions, in which we're making these pledges, and in which we're making these commitments at this COP and outside of this COP. It has to fundamentally address the massive suffering that ordinary people, millions and millions, are experiencing around the world. There is a very clear disconnect by the conversations we tend to have in these corridors and that reality, Gonzalo. And that is the honesty that we're looking for. And I'm really pleased that you offer, because there is absolutely nothing diplomatic about your house being destroyed by a hurricane. There is absolutely nothing diplomatic about you losing a child, a mother, in a flood. There is nothing diplomatic about your family member dying during a pandemic when there was a solution but was hoarded by rich countries. Those injustices, those inequalities, that absolute lack of solidarity is a lesson we've learned in these 2 years. And it cannot be that takes us to 2030. We need a complete reset. We need to put those who are living in poverty and suffering inequality right front and center of all the solutions we put in place as we head to 2030 and as we will get to 2050. But certainly what we're seeing today is not that. We are seeing how can we put in place these net zero targets, which are meaningless to the suffering masses in the world. I will speak in the next round about how I think this can happen, Gonzalo. I'm looking forward to talking about the solutions as well.
Well, thank you. Thanks so much. So if I may, Tasnim, I would like you to start reflecting on, you know, when it comes to the agenda that we're proposing, we have two main metrics, and I'm oversimplifying this. We have two main metrics for Destination 2030, to have emissions in this decade and to build the resilience of 4 billion people. I mean, those are like the main metrics that we have been proposing that are related to both campaigns, Race to Zero, Race to Resilience, and GFAN. What do you think are the key challenges that we're facing, and what are your hopes, and therefore the proposals, the idea that you have that can overcome them?
Thanks, Gonzalo. So the thing is, those are important metrics. What it misses, though, is a reality that we're experiencing. The IPCC Working Group 2 sent us a clear and dire warning that we have entered, not we're going to, we have entered the era of climate impacts. And it is deeply connected, of course, the other side of the coin of 1.5. And that's why 1.5 is a critical metric. But the fact is, as everybody has said, we're not heading for 1.5 at the rate we are committing and pledging and accounting. So in such a situation, what do we need to do? And it's the big elephant in the room in all of these conferences. We have to address the issue of loss and damage due to the impacts of climate change. It is not an issue for the future. It is an issue that needs to be addressed now. Or we are signing off all the millions of people who are suffering these impacts on the front line to no future. I don't want to be harsher than that, but certainly there's no future for people who are going to suffer these frequent impacts. So I would suggest that in those metrics, 1.5, building resilience, which isn't necessarily going to address losses and damages, add the metric of loss and damage and how to deal with it, and finance loss and damage. There's not a cent going to the addressing of loss and damage. And here we're not talking about only humanitarian issues. We're talking about slow onset. Sea level rise has already taken away islands where people lived. We're seeing displacement. We've heard the figures about migration. These things are not things happening in the future, they're happening now. And we need the finance, the resources, and really global solidarity. You know, we talk about cooperation, we're talking about how these non-party stakeholders are all contributing. This piece is missing. We need all of us, non-party stakeholders, parties, governments, etc., to come together in solidarity and deal with this pressing and emergency issues that's not being addressed in any of these pledges that is being made. Important pledges need to be held accountable for them. But what about the people already suffering?
Well, thanks so much, Tasneem. That's why I was... That's why I think I was referring to this being one of the most challenging and important conversations that we have to have, meaning that there are also so many blind spots, and I think that is so critical for us, meaning the non-state actors, what we represent, be capable to learn from those that can enlighten the conversation from things that we have maybe improved in the process, but then definitely things that we need to improve further. So thanks so much. I would go with the same question to you, Magali. Again, what do you think are the key challenges that we're facing, and what are the hopes that you have that can overcome this idea of halving emissions in this decade and building resilience for 4 billion people?
Well, first, I would like to applaud again what both Clover and Tasneem said, because seriously, they are the one who motivate me for my job. I get up every morning and go to job because of them, because their future is in our hands. As not just because of my age, but also because I work for an industry. And industries can change. And it's exactly why today industries can change, but let's not be innocent about it. We have shareholders, we have to deliver. I could tomorrow say, I don't care about the shareholders, I will do my thing, but then if I go bankrupt the next day, I'm not helping anybody. And that's why I was saying the model has to change. The model has to change in such a way that everybody is happy for a company performing by not necessarily making more money, but making more low carbon product. And I know it's a bit different to what you are saying, Clover, and I fully get what you are saying. And I have two daughters who are slightly older than you, but keep me the exact same discourse. I think the industries have to commit seriously, not just fuzzy target, but once validated by science-based targets, such as science-based target initiative, and the government has to work with us to give us this incentive. And I truly think we can do it. I'm a super positive person. I don't think I could do my job if I was not. And I really think we can do it. I really think in our sector, the Cement Association just came with a net zero roadmap. We are all motivated. You had about 40 CEOs of big cement companies agreeing to have a collective action to go down. So it's not that far off. We can maintain the 1.5 degree. It's too late to go below, but we can maintain. I'm absolutely convinced of that, and I'm absolutely convinced that it would be absolutely criminal not to take that opportunity at this COP26 to align what business need to do to function, what government and what Clover and Tasneem needs from their side.
Thanks so much, Magali. We'll go now to Clover with the same question. What do you think are the key challenges in order to get to?
In 30 seconds or less.
in 3 minutes, let's say.
The climate crisis is a symptom of systems that have been designed around the commodification of nature. We live in a culture that values a tree more when it is dead than when it is alive. And systems that have been built on the backs of exploitation and the systematic sacrifice of frontline communities, of the communities we do not see adequately represented in these spaces. One of the biggest challenges in my eyes is that when we talk about climate, we're still talking about it in a kind of convenient way, where we're afraid of the discomfort of actually inviting in systemic transformation, of really embracing the fact that we have to rethink so much of how we live, breathe, and exist in the 21st century. Companies think that sustainability can be a kind of bureaucratic tick-boxing activity that will be solved through, you know, small incremental measures, reducing virgin plastic over here, setting targets a few decades into the future, continuing business as usual, where short-term profits are the major priority. And yet, the goalposts of business fundamentally need to change. Historically, the purpose of creating a product or service has been to create profit, and create profit for a really small group of people. Those goalposts need to fundamentally change so that products and services are created as a vehicle for solving the problems that are defining our times. And the same is true of policy. We need to rethink the mechanisms and engines that put people into seats of power. Short-term politics is not going to solve this crisis. This is the most immediate, existential, complex challenge we have ever faced. And so we fundamentally need to transform and we need to rethink. And of course, we need to invite new ways of thinking into these spaces. It is a farce to think that we will solve this problem with the same thinking and the same people who created it. We need in these rooms young people who are not willing to abide by the status quo, and we need in these rooms people for whom the climate crisis is already their lived experience and their present day reality. We continue to talk about the global south as victims of the climate crisis, which is absolutely true. The global south are being disproportionately impacted by the climate crisis while they have contributed the least to it. And yet they are also the greatest holders of solutions and knowledge and experience of what grassroots resilience looks like and what that better, brighter future can look like too. So we need to have the courage to sit not only in the apocalyptic doomsday images that come so easily to the front of our minds, but we need to have the courage to sit in a radically different future and bring that future into the present. And we will only do that by inviting people who have been historically excluded into these spaces.
Thanks so much, Chloe. Couldn't agree more. So, Johan, the voice of science, how do we get to the building resilience of 4 billion people and halving the emissions from now to 2030?
Yeah, let me take two angles to that. I mean, first of all, I really would like to respect and recognize Clover's and all young people's anger, because you have a double reason for anger. I mean, reason number one is, of course, that we are threatening to destabilize the life support systems and push the planet along irreversible commitments, which means that we'll be drifting away towards worse and worse living conditions on Earth because we've crossed tipping points that we cannot control. But the second reason for anger is that not only do we have the solutions, we have all the evidence that we can scale it and we can have better outcomes for security, for equity, for health, for economy, for peace. Can you imagine a renewable energy future means for the first time in human history, we can have energy independence in every country in the world? Isn't that just amazing for any economy? It should be the most attractive target point for any nation. So there's double reason for frustration, not moving fast enough. And I think that's one task here in Glasgow, which we are very close to, the new winning narrative. We're sitting on the winning narrative, which means that it's not a question anymore whether we will decarbonize the world economy, it's just a question of will we land fast enough. And the very provocative statement from science is that in the task of lists we have to accomplish to deliver Paris, the phase out of fossil fuels is the easy one. There's no excuse to not do it because it's much tougher to transition the food system.
It's much tougher to transition the world economy and all our behaviors and choices and the cultural parts. It's much tougher to get justice and equity in place so that we can share the remaining space within planetary boundaries in a fair way. My definition, my ultimate definition of equity and justice is a stable planet. Every child and human being's right of a stable planet. What right do we have as adults being on watch today to hand over a planet which is in a less livable condition than the one we were born on? I mean, that's unacceptable. So no, we have so much more to do than phase out fossil fuels. Let's just tick that one off now.
Thanks so much. Well, thank the four of you for what I think it was a very, I mean, again, challenging and extremely important and thoughtful discussion. This was really an extremely powerful moment for all of us, at least definitely was for me. I assume that for all of the people listening to all of us, and I'm grateful that we took the time to explore the challenges that lie ahead. So I will invite you to leave the stage, because now I would need to invite our next speaker. Thanks so much. Wow, that was really powerful. So thank you. And I would like to invite onto stage our honorable COP26 President Alok Sharma to share his reflection on this conversation and our chance to reach our shared destination in 2030.
Gonzalo, thank you very much for that. And ladies and gentlemen, friends, it's a pleasure to join you this afternoon. And look, I want to thank both the panels for their really powerful insights. And I think these discussions reflect very clearly the discussions that have been led by Nigel and Gonzalo over the past 2 years now. This is about bringing all non-state actors together as part of this conversation. And I think it just demonstrates what many of us have been saying for a long period of time, is that if we're going to get there, we're going to get a solution on this issue, then it is going to require all of us to act and work together. And so whether that's reducing emissions or adapting to the effects of climate change or getting finance flowing, all of those require an all of society approach. And I just want to thank Nigel and Gonzalo for really, I mean, the brilliant work that they have done through the Race to Zero campaign and the Race to Resilience. We've got over 5,000 businesses, many of them big multinational businesses, signed up to Race to Zero. We've got, I think, 60% of the UK's FTSE 100, our largest companies, who are part of this. I mean, I have to say, I really think this is an extraordinary achievement. And, you know, I've seen this grow. Can we please have a special hand for these two great guys? But the reality is, this event and this summit is not about congratulating ourselves. This is about recognizing that, yes, we have made progress, but there is much further to go. And each of you have got your own experiences of what climate change really means. Now, I've had the privilege over this past year to visit countries, to talk to communities, many of them on the front line of climate change. Just to give you a few examples, I was in Barbuda a few months ago, and those of you who have been to Barbuda will know that 4 years ago it was hit by a hurricane. And there's been some construction, there's been some reconstruction. But actually, if you stand there in the middle of that community, you still see large numbers of homes with their roofs ripped off. You see walls crumbling. And I had an opportunity to speak to the community leaders who are still on the island. Many people have had to leave. It's effectively forced migration. I mean, I would argue that climate change is the biggest security risk that we face in the world right now. And their message was very clear to me, which is that what they are seeing is these climate events becoming more frequent and more ferocious. And that's why their big ask is for all of us, but particularly the biggest economies, to play their part in terms of cutting emissions. I spoke a few days ago to women in Madagascar who are having to cope with what I think some have called the first climate-induced drought, famine in the world. 4 years, no rain. You can imagine what that's like. You spent your life farming, you can no longer farm. You then turn to fishing, you can no longer fish, but you still have to find a way of feeding your family. That's the sort of challenge that people are facing. I mean, I could go through and give you other testaments that I've had from people around the world, but the reality is that it is very, very tough right now, already, for millions and millions of people. And so I think what that has done is strengthen my own resolve to drive progress on issues like loss and damage, which we heard about, on adaptation. And, you know, I'm pleased with the commitments that have been made on adaptation finance that have been announced at this COP. I hope there will be others. We need to go further. We need to have a balance between the money spent on adaptation and mitigation. We can't continue with countries seeing adaptation as somehow the poor cousin of mitigation. That cannot be the case. And, you know, I've also had an opportunity in this role to see the work that's been done by young people, by civil society, by researchers, by local government, by financial institutions, by businesses. And, you know, we talk about how far business has moved. I tell you, I mean, I started my business career in the 1990s, and I started in the City of London. And in 2020, we launched, many years later, we launched the finance campaign for COP26. The Guildhall was absolutely filled to the rafters. I mean, literally standing room only. That would not have been the case when I started my career in finance, I can tell you that. It has gone mainstream. I think we have gone past that tipping point where governments, businesses, civil society are thinking in the same way on this. The question is pace, how quickly we get through this and get it done. I've been to countries where the reason governments are acting is because they are being pushed by businesses, they're being pushed by civil society. And there are some countries where businesses need to basically take these governments along with them, tell them that actually we will welcome if you act on cutting emissions. And, you know, civil society, I've had the privilege of meeting young people, civil society groups in every country that I have visited. And it's been really incredibly powerful to listen to those voices, to hear what they are doing locally. And of course, today we have the COP Youth and Public Empowerment Day, and we've got young policy experts inspiring ministers to keep 1.5 within reach. And you will know that two comprehensive statements have been put forward by youth today, and they've spent an enormous amount of time on this. And we talked about, you know, young people feeling angry. You heard that on one of the panels. Well, they have every right to be angry. Well, of course they do. Because world leaders haven't, up to this point, delivered on their promises. They haven't acted fast enough. And that's what we need to happen right now. At the start of the summit, we had world leaders, 120 world leaders, all committing to action. And what I'm going to be doing in these negotiations, when ministers get here and we get into the real detail of all of this next week, is to say to those ministers, to those negotiators, please reflect in your commitments what your leader said on a world stage. And I think in terms of youth being part of the discussion, they are part of the discourse, and one of the things we have committed to is there is a statement, that there are words that I think young people would like to see reflected in the cover decision, and we've said we will take that, we will talk about that with countries, with parties, with negotiators, so that voice can be reflected in the negotiating rooms as well. And then we come to the scientists, and we heard from scientists and business people here, and frankly, without science entering the public debate, frankly, we wouldn't have had the Paris goals. We wouldn't now know that we were at least 1.1 degree of global warming above pre-industrial levels, and the window on keeping 1.5 alive is closing. Now look, there has been some progress. Before Paris, The analysis, some analysis out there suggesting we were heading towards 6 degrees of global warming post the Paris commitments. That temperature curve had been sort of taken downwards to under 4 degrees. And if you look at some of the analysis out there now, it suggests that the curve has been bent further towards 2 degrees. But that requires every single government to actually deliver on all the commitments that they've made. It's not enough to make commitments. You have to follow through with action as well. And that's why it is not job done by any stretch of the imagination. I want us to leave here being able to say with credibility that we have kept 1.5 within reach. And you will know there are countries in the world where 1.5 to stay alive means literally that. Now, we've seen some useful announcements here, good announcements. You will know now that we've got 90% of the global economy covered by a net zero target. It's less than 30% when we took on the COP presidency. We've got over 100 countries signed the Global Methane Pledge. We've got over 130 countries representing 90% of the world's forests committing to halt and reverse forest loss by 2030. It's been backed by around $19 billion worth of support. We've got financial institutions who've signed up to eliminating investments linked to deforestation. You've seen more announcements in terms of consigning coal power to history and all the corporates and the countries that have signed up further. You've seen the First Mover Coalition that was launched at COP, committing countries like Apple, Dalmia Cement, Volvo, Fortescue, others to be buying low-carbon products by 2030. And this is all, of course, positive. But I think what it demonstrates is that there is a willingness and there is a momentum to go further. But ultimately, we are going to have to get through these negotiations. And I have to say to you, there will come a point over the next few days where the rubber literally hits the road. We have been trying to reach agreement on some of these issues for 6 years. And that's reflected in the frustration that you heard from some of the panelists here. And so we're going to have to roll up our sleeves. We're going to have to ensure that we are able to close off the Paris rulebook. We're going to have to ensure that we close off Article 6 and ultimately unleash the full power of the Paris Agreement. These next few days are going to be absolutely decisive. So what I request from you, from each and every one of you, please help me. Help me in this process to apply the pressure on governments, apply the pressure on negotiators. Tell them that we cannot leave Glasgow without being able to say with credibility that we have kept 1.5 within reach. And I want to end on a positive note, which is that I do believe, based on what we have seen from governments, from non-state actors, I do believe that there is a green net zero future ahead of us. The real issue is, will we get there fast enough? And I need your help to ensure that the answer to that is yes at the end of this conference. Thank you.